All right, it looks like a big hand of 12.
Legislature, actually.
So let's begin, shall we? Everybody ready?
Yes.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Okay. So we start with approving minutes, it looks like. Am I right, Mary Ellen?
Correct.
So let's move to approve minutes of September 14, October 3, October 12, November 14, and December 12. Where were we? Anyway, that's the motion.
With an amendment that we have to eliminate the second period.
Second period.
After 12 minutes.
Or add a third.
Okay, third.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded. And how about the original motion?
Second.
Me too. So minutes are approved. Now, on to number two, scheduled appointment, 6 p.m., Water Department, update on merger with Water District.
Want me to talk? You want to talk?
You can talk.
So an update on the last we talked, or the last special town meeting we had, there was $40,000 appropriated to hire an engineer for final design of the connection of the two systems. Since that time, it was myself, Wayne, the Water Commissioners, and Representative from the Water District, interviewed four different engineering firms. And the unanimous pick was Brookshire Design Group. Brookshire Design Group, you know, as opposed to Brookshire Engineering.
Good choice.
Which is currently working with the Water Department. They were the cheapest, and they had the most relevant experience. They had done a very similar project in Northampton, which required them to install a booster station to survey, and it was a subdivision, a new subdivision in Northampton. So essentially the same project. The recommendation from the Water Commissioners is that the town would hire Brookshire Design.
Okay.
So we need to make a motion. Motion to hire Brookshire Design based upon the recommendation of the Water Commissioners and the representatives of the district.
Second. In favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, good.
Perfect timing.
Oh, before we go any farther, maybe we have a TV audience, why don't we go around the table and just say who we are and what committee we're on? So Brian, you want to start?
I'm Brian Donovan, the town administrator.
Jim Kirkendall, Finance Committee.
Fred Barron, Finance Committee.
Paul Newman, Select Board.
Fred Rolasky, Select Board.
Jonathan Edwards, Select Board.
Paul Antaya, Finance Committee.
Dan Kennedy, Finance Committee.
Okay, thanks. Okay, moving right along to Finance Committee, Town Hall Project Planning Scenarios.
Paul?
No?
Can we get Lynn in first?
Lynn, come in. Lynn Sibley. Treasurer Clerk.
We are borrowing money again for the highway truck.
At a good rate, huh?
At a good rate, 2.2%.
Not bad.
So I need some signatures.
Oh, my God, I guess you do.
So you're going to sign here. Pass it along.
And here, no, that's you.
No, that's me.
That's you.
That's it for you, Mr. Rodney Mayor.
Where's my stamp?
Auto pass. Where is this in the agenda?
It is.
Three years.
It's further down, I think.
This is 3 years, right?
3 years. It's
Both hands now.
$47,000 for 2 years and $46,000 for 1 year. We borrowed $140,000. The dump truck.
Oh, the dump truck, right, right.
We're coming back.
Dump truck.
It's a little less than the last dump truck.
Well, is this set up for no prepaid penalties in the event we find some cash?
I'm not sure about that in this case.
Is that something?
They don't say it specifically on the loans, but.
Shoot the crickets.
Yeah, I got to sign it too, so.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Is the finance committee expecting any of the other members?
I think at this point, not.
So I would really request that Mary Ellen come up here.
I think that's a great idea.
Go on, Mary Ellen, don't be shy.
Well, that's part of the calculus, absolutely.
I always bring an extra pen.
She makes me smart.
I usually send it to Paul.
I got my.
All
right, so speaking of finance committee, how about town hall project funding scenarios?
Yeah, just to give you, we had a meeting, the finance committee had a meeting in December with the historical commission. And at that time, the historical commission did a fine job of bringing us up to speed on the various approaches to funding of the town hall renovation and update as to where things are. At that time, I believe, and finance committee members can correct me on that, but you guys probably have a number of, you have the scenarios. We were warming up to scenario 2B on this. I believe I'm right, Dan?
I'm pretty sure that's what it is.
And we, at that time, did not take a formal vote because of, we wanted to be absolutely sure of the impact that this would have on the town. And also, we wanted to be in conjunction with the select board on this funding approach. And we thought it was wise that we reconvene and just have a discussion about this one last time before we take the final vote on it. So that's where we are, and that's why we're here.
And the final vote would be a recommending?
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
So on scenario 2B, we're not doing. Question is, let's say for argument's sake that the final project comes in under 1.2, just for argument's sake. Would that mean that of the five line items that we're getting, or the four actually, because one's not funded on that line item, of the four line items where we're getting revenue from, would the one that benefited from that lower cost be the town funds, or would it be just proportional across the board?
I would think it's still depends on the grant.
See, the timing of this is everything, and how this is worded is important as well, because we have to $315,000. Are we all going to be in agreement that this be turned over to the town hall initiative free of any contingencies? So by that, should we asterisk this to indicate that the 315 is good to go on our part, provided that there is this funding to go along with it? Because if not, I mean, is it just going to, I mean, where does it go? Where does it sit? Who has access to it? All of those questions have to come into play. And in order to, I think, safeguard this windfall money, because this is windfall, in order to safeguard that for the town, I think we need to develop verbiage around how we indicate to spend this.
I just comment on that as chair of the, speaking now as chair of the building committee. We've talked about this and looked at various scenarios, and we got to remember that for the state grants, we need a match, town right. funds, and for one of them grants, we cannot use CPA funds. So for the bigger one that we're trying for, the cultural facilities grant of either 275 or 290 we're looking at now, we need one-for-one match.
Mm-hmm.
or we don't get the full amount. So we need at least $290 of the $315 for that match.
Right.
For the other one, we can use CPA funds for. So to answer kind of your question, which one is going to, or back to Jonathan's question, which one is going to benefit if we don't need the $1.2 million? It's probably going to be the either private funding or the CPA lump sum.
Because town funds isn't negotiable?
Because no, because town funds is needed.
They got media cash. That's assuming the cultural facilities fund.
Yeah, that's assuming.
I guess my question would be that, and it's, I guess I'm a little in the dark, because if the town funds line item is a match, then why isn't that consistent with 2A? Because it's the same request of 525 from state grants, but the town funds is significantly less than 315.
There's debt service in there.
Well, I get that. But then you're using debt service as your match.
But the match can be public or private funds.
Okay,
there's $150,000 in private funds there, and
there's $150,000 in both scenarios, though.
Right. So you're going to be short in 2A. You're $90,000 less than you are in 2B. So,
essentially, right now, at this point in time, from a calendar perspective, they can't afford 2A because they have to have a matching amount, and it has to be submitted tomorrow, right?
Ryan and I have pushed it to Wednesday morning, but it really has to be finished Wednesday morning.
Okay, well, that's helpful.
Yeah, for the grants, we need to show matching not only for the town funds, but other funds that are being used for the total budget for the project to show the town has a commitment in it. We're just not out there looking for grants to fund it all. And if you look at the CPA lump sum in the town, that's 525, 530. That's about half of the project. And I guess we need to show that in the application,
right,
that we're serious about it. We have town funds in it. And the other thing to keep in mind is, I guess we're looking at this for the annual town meeting. The schedule for doing work in the town hall, we won't know grants until after the town meeting, June or July. By the time we hear about that, and if we're successful with all the grants, we have all the money we need, the schedule is probably go out for bids in December, I would, November, December, start construction probably March of 18. So we're going to need the funding in place by October, November, whatever, of this year. And I guess my recommendation is that we set this money aside from the cell tower residual here, the 315, or I would even say, I don't know if it's going to be a bookkeeping issue to have $12,074, put the whole amount in, $331,074. For the town hall project. And that would take care of that fund, that amount that's remaining in that fund. Why have 11,000 or whatever left in there for future, I guess, that we don't know right now. But,
if I could take a step back quickly. So scenario one is really what we're showing as worst case scenario. That's no, you know, scenario one is we don't receive any of these grants. There's three grants that are being pursued. One is the Cultural Facilities Fund grant, the second is Green Communities grant, and the third one is Cultural Preservation Fund. So that's what scenario two would be. We receive all those grants, everything's great. Scenario one is we receive none of those grants. And then three, four, and five are different iterations of we receive some, we don't receive others. Well, I think what's being focused on now is what portion of town funds should be committed or could be committed to the project.
So I guess my next, can I ask one other question? Do you mind, Paul?
No.
Which Paul?
Either Paul. I get the need to earmark the match. Once we earmark the match, down the road, could CPA debt take the place of part of that match?
Depends on the grant.
Okay, but so it is possible to lessen the impact on the town funds requirement, potentially.
Well, it would be down to 290 if that's what we're asking for. For that grant that needs non-CPA money, so it's either coming from town funds or private funding, I guess.
May I? I mean, this is a complicated situation because, as Paul Intea said, there's so many things we don't know because of the timing of the grant decisions. But we are putting in a proposal this week for $290,000. We have a little bit over $90,000 already raised in private funds, so we're not at zero. Okay. I think we know we can't say that the town has appropriated the funds because that can't happen until April. But I'm just going to rise above Brian. What Brian's going to have to deal with about, you know, how you deal with this in the future, you know, setting money aside, not using it, that kind of thing. If we were able to say that at a minimum, these two groups, the select board and the finance committee, have agreed together to recommend a minimum of $200,000. I'd rather have the whole 330 also, but a minimum of $200,000. That's nice, clean math. You know, we're still going to try to raise more private money. We'll still do some other things, but that would be nice, clean math for this proposal. And you understand, you know, it's a proposal. We're not signing a legal agreement. We're painting a picture of where we stand.
Yeah, that's a way of looking at it. I guess I would like to tie up the full amount whatever is available. But also keep it in mind, if you look at all these other scenarios, who's borrowing involved? It's the only scenario where there's no borrowing to the town. All we're asking for is a warrant article to prove that money, which was kind of a gift to the town for the cell tower, used for buildings. We did it for this building. We saw all the publicity we got for this building in the newspaper and all that. I think it shows we are being fiscally responsible as board members here to using the town's money wisely, and I think this is just continuing along that effort.
Well,
if we don't get all the grants, well, then we've got to look at either short-term or long-term debt, and you can see all these scenarios have that. That's another, I guess, topic of discussion later on.
I think the Finance Committee, during our last meeting, we felt similar to what Fred just stated, in that this was windfall money, and we have been able to direct, you know, large portions of that cell tower money towards debt, this building here, and also something very specific, which would be the old town hall, and it's something that we can speak to, versus having departments in town nickel and dime this money over time, and not being able to put your finger on anywhere that it went. Mm-hmm. So from that perspective, I think we felt most comfortable about scenario 2B. The reservation is, what if the grants don't come in? What happens to the money? Where does it go? And how do we control it? So I think that's the portion Finance Committee would feel that we have to put some strings around.
I think the town should commit the full amount of the cell tower money. But I don't think it's prudent to go with plan with 2B, which assumes no borrowing, and assumes you're getting the full amount of each of the grants. I think if we assume that there's going to be some level of borrowing, $100,000, $150,000, some level to cover. If all the grants come in, that money just gets paid back. That it'll be sitting there extra and just goes and repays the loan. But I think to assume we're not going to have to borrow, and then if a grant doesn't come in, then we're scrambling to have to borrow on short notice, or I'd rather be prepared with the funding upfront and know, you know, assume some level of debt, which can be repaid, can be secured by future CPA revenues. It doesn't have to be out of current income.
Sure, Judy.
The Historical Commission and the Building Committee submitted an application to the CPC for up to $1 million because we had to get something in. And we're hopeful that this CPC has not voted yet. It really hasn't discussed in depth yet, but they were receptive and positive towards the project in the discussion. It's our expectation that depending on what happens either here or subsequently, to the extent that money from the cell tower fund would be available, that could be reduced. But I think the expectation we had was that the CPA would borrow to make up for any shortfall, as Fred just said, make up any shortfall in the grants. And this would be secured from future CPA revenues. And
which had no impact on tax
no
rate.
Impact
right.
On tax rate.
But the other thing that...
The point I wanted to make is we have the application in place that will cover that. Like
and I just want to reiterate, my point is, I just don't think it's wise to assume we're going to get the full amount.
Right. The rosy economic scenarios are always...
Right. So let's go with a worst case scenario, and if we get it all, then it's sitting there and it gets paid back.
Where's the worst case scenario? Zero state funds.
That no grants received is the...
First one, A.
But keep in mind, if we don't get any...
That would be no... So one B.
One B.
Okay, but that's still using town funds. Keep in mind, and I know that the CPA is indicated they would support the $1 million over. Or whatever. Right, but that's only gonna get you some $700,000 of money because you've got the interest on top of that. So you're still gonna be, if you go to the 1.2, 500,000 short, which could be made up with town funds and private funding. Or even a lump sum community preservation fund. So if you don't get any grants, you could borrow CPA. You'd need to have either short-term or long-term debt. Town would have to approve it, and you would have enough money to cover the project, but you're gonna need debt to do that. The other thing that we're still dealing with on the building committee is, if we don't get the 1.2 million, funding for this, can we do less? Can we do this in phases? We've talked some with the architect, who's still dealing with that in the next meeting coming up. What could we do less? And the only thing you're gonna do less is the parking lot. The building itself and the stair tower and lift in the back, kind of package deal, they all fit together. To separate them, you're gonna have more cost than in doing it combined. So that's the minimum. They're working on giving us a price, if that was the minimum we needed, and then a price for the parking lot. Now it would be bid as out for the 1.2 million, give us a price for that, and then if you did not do the parking, it'd be a deduct, subtract the parking, what would be a bid price be? And that's what we're trying to do.
In that parking lot.
I would guess 200,000 maybe?
That's only the
option two. We're looking at the one in the back as well.
Yeah.
So at 100, 150 maybe? Yeah. I don't know. So it's not like half. It is a little, but the parking could function, other than we'll do some handicap access parking. Yeah. Could function the way it is until you know, in the future, there's always CPA money 2-3 years from now that could be built up to do that, or green communities, or the, what's the, complete streets.
CPA is not going to pay for parking lots.
No, I'm not sure what CPA is.
Okay, or complete streets.
It's not a historic park.
Okay, or complete streets. Complete streets is the one down the road that we haven't applied for yet either, so.
Dan, you have a point?
I just like to express an opinion that it has nothing to do with the town hall. It's everything to do with financial prudence for the town. We have no budget numbers. Capital Appreciation Committee hasn't met yet. We're $280,000 short on our general stabilization fund. This money you're talking about is like 38% of our available funds. And I just think we're headed down the wrong path. The timing's poor, I get it for the grant. But I think until we see a budget and we know where this town's going, I think it's just fiscally irresponsible for us to be putting out 40% of our available cash to a project. It's not a critical project, it's an important project, don't get me wrong, but it's just our timing is just way off base as far as I'm concerned. We should at least be able to look at the budget, see where the town stands. If there's $500,000 left, give it to the town hall. I don't have an issue with that. But until we get there, we're spending our money up front. We have no idea what this year is bringing us. We know the high school's coming at us with warrant articles over and above budget. The elementary school's coming at us with the safety concerns because their intercom doesn't work any longer, so when they have a lockdown, they can't announce it. So there's monies that we're not going to be able to say no to. There's the fire departments, their turnout gear, $78,000 is obsolete. I mean, it's just coming at us left and right. And we're obligating 40% of our monies now. I just think it's totally irresponsible on especially on the finance committee's part, who the town counts on you guys to be the watchdog to everything. The select board they've got a lot of balls to juggle. It's more of a political post. The finance committee is where it stands. And I really think you're letting the town down by moving this money so soon. Move it later. Once you've seen your numbers, move it. But until you see those numbers, I don't see how you can possibly make this decision.
Well, I mean, I get you, Dan. Look, I mean, if it wasn't for the Finance Committee, we probably would have gone ahead with a $3.9 million increase 2 years ago, and your tax bill right now would be right through the roof. But we didn't do that because the Finance Committee felt pretty strong that wasn't the right way to go. You're right about bad timing. This is not, this is a long way from ideal. In two respects. One, we don't have a budget to look at. Okay. Number two, we have a timing issue here.
So
we're trying to balance.
Yeah, well, the balance or importance?
Balance,
well,
right.
But importance is subjective, remember, Dan.
Well, not if you've got a budget rolling at you.
No, but I guess my point is that you talked about a few items that you knew were going to be coming up. I'm not saying one's more important than the other, but priorities are subjective. And if you're gonna choose to spend money on X instead of Y, that's fine. But it's individual priorities that people feel is important for the town.
Right, but
that's
you have to know what those choices are. You're not letting those choices even come to the forefront.
Well, you just mentioned some.
Well, because I've looked into it. Does anybody else know these choices here? I don't think so.
But I think it's important for finance to tell the people that are submitting projects through the capital improvement program that give them an idea of the amount of money that's available. And if we take the 330 off the table, we know that, or they should know that you're not gonna spend that much money. If you get enough projects in there, all these other things come in from the school, and it comes to more than what the 1.2 million is with all the other categories, you can still go back and look at, okay, do we need to take some of the 331? We haven't spent it. You still have time before the warrant articles to come out to do it, so it's not like you're forever removing the $331,000. It's just off the table right now, and once we get all these other requests in there, you can look at it again and say, okay, that's fine, we don't need to touch that for other projects.
But then how can the grant say that this money is obligated as a match?
They're not saying it's obligated.
That wouldn't be true.
They're not saying it is.
Then why are we even discussing it?
To set aside that money, well, for two things, set aside the money so it isn't looked at by others to, as a pot of funds for projects, and two, for the grants, to apply for the grants.
And I think, to answer your question, Jen, I think the reason we're discussing it is that when we, Historical Commission, had our conversation just before Christmas with the Finance Committee, I came away thinking that we were pretty close to being able to say that the Finance Committee has expressed positive inclination toward, we'll come up with a sentence that everybody has approved, to be able to say the Finance Committee and the Select Board makes it all that much clearer. But the draft proposal, Brian and I are working on it every day, is really clear that this will not be filed until the
Well, exactly. So it's not,
You can't obligate.
No one's going to cash a check tomorrow for these funds. But along with that, and yet, this money is in effect not operational money. This is money, this is almost like lottery money. And, you know, the state says you can't use lottery money to offset your operational costs. This is almost the same thing, where this town has to operate without this.
It's no different than what we've gone through in the past years. This is additional money. And we've made it through the budget last all of the years with what has been thrown at us, right? Between stabilization and reserve. And we're going to do the same thing this year. This is outside money.
I understand totally.
Well,
all I'm saying is about the timing.
On the budget.
Right. Timing is great.
Ryan, could you elaborate on what kind of projects would be eligible for that money if it wasn't used for this building? What, there's restrictions.
You just signed a dump truck loan for $200,000. That would
be liable. I'm talking of the 331. Well, I don't know. Is dump truck available for, would be a reasonable project for that money?
So the intent of the restrictions on the fund set forth in the statute are that if you sell a hard asset, you can spend money on a hard asset. It's a little bit more detailed than that.
Like a building.
Like a building.
Which we've already got.
Or debt.
Or a truck.
Equipment. Equipment with a, there's different provisions in Mass General Law that say you can borrow more than 5 years to purchase XYZ. You can spend it on those types of items as well. It can't be used to offset.
Your salary.
You know, soft assets or operating budgets.
You guys, we sat at this table, and when we decided on the path to take the lump sum, we knew it was going to be a feeding frenzy. We talked about it and said, it's going to be a feeding frenzy. Line up now. It's going to happen. So, and what we were doing was we were making a deal with the devil to say, we're going to be grown up enough to make the hard decisions on how we're going to prioritize spending all this money. There's not a right or a wrong. There's a how do we collectively decide the path we're going to take.
And if you take this money to offset your budgeting this year, what's going to happen next year when you don't have it? Because it ended up going into five departments, and we still have a building in the middle of town that's fallen down. I mean, I think collectively we've made the decision that we don't want to mothball that thing, that we don't want to sell it so that there's a brew house in there, although that's not a bad idea. You know, I think people generally feel that. And now that, I just don't see us having this money again.
And I think we're approaching the end of the road for really for doing anything on a town hall. Mm-hmm. This is it. This is the last
design pretty much
project we're getting, and we've got schedules to move ahead forward, and we need to have some assurances of funding.
And if there's no, if we don't get the matching, then that's another conversation. But all we can do right now is to ensure that this $300,000 plus dollars is earmarked one way, but yet we've developed language around that so that in the event that funding doesn't come through, those, that money goes back to the general fund and we can use it at that time.
Well, the general fund would be exceptions based upon...
With the, right.
And there's one other thing about the time. If we kick this can down the road to next year, next January, we're going to have the exact same timing problem.
It's going to be worse next year.
Of what's coming up with the budget and what, you know, we don't have a budget yet and the grant proposals. I mean, it's not going to make any difference as far as what we know a year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now. We're going to be in the same position in January of having to put in grant proposals without knowing what a budget is.
Right.
And we're going to have the same sort of worthwhile projects, you know, hanging over our heads that have to be done. But they may be different ones, but it's going to be the same decision.
And I got to say, I really do think that we made the decision back when we paid off the debt of this building, that we weren't going to save the cell tower revenue for a rainy day capital need. We made that decision. We made the decision because we felt, A, we didn't want to pay debt service, as small as amount as that is, but B, we were going to bat for the possibility of renting the space to a for-profit entity, which, by the way, need I remind anyone, is a roll of the dice. There's no guarantee we can rent that space. We're going to try, but there's no guarantee there's a market for that space. So we've made the decision to not reserve that money. We didn't make the decision to reserve part of it. We made the decision we were going to spend it down based upon the needs of the town. Mm-hmm.
And in that discussion, it was offset the $220,000 a year hit from the loss of the tax revenue of Conestro.
In 2 years, not this year.
This is one of the years. So now we, because we'll be looking at next year's budget. So if we offset 220, pay off a truck, whatever it takes, that's how you do it. You don't just lump sum it out to a non-crucial project that only affects a certain part of the town. You're right, we won a lottery, and everybody should be sharing in the lottery win.
You're looking at expenses that you think would happen in next year.
No, you just signed it.
Wait a minute, nobody's saying, what additional revenues are we going to get next year? If we rent this space, that's additional revenue. We've got houses being built in town, that's additional revenue coming in. You got to look at the whole picture, just not the negative side. What do we need money to spend on? And today, we don't know a year, fiscal year 19 budget, what that's going to be, our revenues. We don't know that.
Fred, you saw what your new valuations did. We're cracking almost $16 per thousand.
Yeah, well, that wasn't only because of Conestro.
No, it's because of Conestro.
That's not the only reason.
It's one of the main ones.
Also a loss of $50,000 a year in cell tower.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's gone next year.
Okay.
Because you're offset with the $36,000, you're $14 off.
If we don't set aside what is necessary for matching funds, we walk away from the opportunity to apply for grants. In which case, if we are going to do work on town hall, the town is funding all of it because we just won't have access to that sort of funding. If right now we say that we are setting aside the money and we put that in the grant proposals, the way I can speak for the Mass Preservation Fund grant, I don't know the cultural fund, with the preservation fund, if we do not have that money, if we are awarded a grant, we then have to produce the money. We don't have to produce the money at application, we have to produce it at award. Which means if down the road there is an emergency and we find that we need those funds and we're going to delay town hall, we can appropriate that money and walk away from the grant at that point. I'm not recommending we do that, because as I said, if we don't have the funds approved to match, we get the funding. So it ends up costing the town.
Is this the same grant that we have to have in by Wednesday, we're talking about?
No.
So that grant can be covered by CPA funds, is my understanding.
No. That one can be, but with this one, you know,
that's right.
I mean, they're both state grants, so I would be surprised if they're not similar to the state.
They're quite different.
They don't, when do they make sure the money's in the bank?
I don't know.
When does the money need to, I understand that we need to commit it. If we, in August, I'm going to pick it up.
If we do what in August?
In August, if all of a sudden we found out that we're broke as a town, and I'm being a little
dramatic. Yeah.
About the issues.
Okay.
You're asking if you could walk away from the state, a state funding commitment? Yes.
Could you delay the state funding commitment or just walk away?
Maybe. I mean, they are all different.
I get it.
And again, you know.
So we're closing our options if we vote no. All of our options are still on the table if we vote yes.
Absolutely. And maybe I would just say two other things. Just to repeat what I said earlier, I think simply saying, explaining the timing and saying that these two groups are positively inclined to recommending town support, and put a number, I agree, is very important. I also think any of these proposals are going to be very weak if we convey the impression that the town is not willing to put a dollar of its own into this. They'll say, you know, well, really, you know. So there's that kind of thing. The other thing I would say about the trade-offs over the summer, you know, whoever said this, it's true. The chances of getting 100% of what we ask for three state funding. I mean, I won't say they're nil, but boy, they're low.
You know, it's budget climate,
but the trade-off is not higher property taxes. It's borrowing more against the CPA. That's really, and the nice thing about Brian's scenarios are, which we talked about in great detail with the Finance Committee, they show that even the worst case scenario is, which we don't want to do, is manageable with the stream of CPA funding we have now. So there's no rake to step on, except for that trade-off.
Well, and it also seems to me like one of the reasons for going for one of these scenarios is that we have the ability to leverage these funds, that if we pass it up, we lose all the funds we can leverage, and then we're in a worse hole, worse shape, and the prospects of doing anything proactive for the town hall in the future get dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. And there has been significant debate about what to do with the town hall, and the outcome has been pretty decisively that we want to fix the town hall up, and here's our opportunity, and if we don't take this opportunity now, it's going to be less likely we will have an opportunity in the future. Certainly.
There won't be an opportunity in the future, because you'll have to go to the town and you'll have to ask them people to take money out of their pocket.
Okay, so from here, what's our goal with this discussion? Are we to give a sense of the two boards that we would like, for the sake of writing these grants, that we feel as a finance and select board, that it's in the best interest of the town to conditionally state that we would like to use money in the ways of one of these scenarios to help obtain these grants. I don't know exactly how to word the motion, but
I would be recommending to the town that they set aside, even if town meeting were tomorrow, recommended to the town. Yeah.
Well, it's kind of going to be a warrant article. It will come to a warrant article.
Right.
So eventually, and you could say recommended by finance, select board, building committee, and historic commission. If you want, you've got all the players right here for that warrant article.
You have to include something in that article that addresses an issue of non-funding on the other side. Because there are going to be many people in that room that are going to ask, well, what if this state fund doesn't come through? What if this grant doesn't come through? What happens to that money? Where does it go? You have to address that in the warrant. And I think we have to have some kind of insurance around it that if the walls come tumbling down, we can go and get it at some point.
I think the answer to that would be, if none of the grants come through, then we're going back to the CPA funding, borrowing for the 20 years.
That's Plan B is CPA borrowing against future revenue.
Well, that's what has to be.
And the town funds come back, go back to the town.
Well, that depends on how much. The level of borrowing.
Yeah, no, I guess my only point, Fred, is that if we're selling this as we need to secure this because of the grants,
Yeah. That's
how we're selling this. So if we don't get the grants, I think it's only fair to come back and have a conversation about whether any of the 315.
Well, I think you're doing it to secure the grants and to reduce or eliminate borrowing or tax increases. It's not just to secure the grants. It's to keep the tax rate from going up to fund this project.
Right. Well, but if CPA were to cover the vast majority of it, I don't think that.
I'm not sure the CPA can cover the whole.
I didn't say the whole thing, I said the vast majority of it. If you combine CPA.
You still need short-term borrowing, Jonathan, that you're going to have to ask for.
That's not big money.
Well, you're talking $1 million asking people to borrow, and
at
you're going to pay back.
At 2.something%.
I don't know that the CPA can. The CPA can borrow short-term, too, I think.
Right.
Yeah. But I'm not sure the CPA can cover debt service for the whole $1 million.
Yeah, there's not
the
enough.
Town money isn't
right.
There.
Right, it's not enough. It's only going to give you the 800,000 here, 800,000.
You know, I think we have to also be realistic and understand that, let's say nothing comes through. It's over. You get the 300, and, you know, CPA, how much can you realistically borrow from that?
Well, if you look at the funding levels here, without, if any grants don't come through, you still got the 500,000. You got town funds, private funding, and assuming the CPC gives you a lump sum, that's 670,000. So you're going to end up CPA funds going for the 500,000 is borrowing.
Yeah,
if nothing comes through, you still, if you have these other funds committed, you've got half the project paid for.
The CPA lump sum is there. It's essentially
right.
Committed.
The lump sum.
The private funding is there or anticipated to be there. So that even without the town, you're talking about roughly a quarter of the project or more is funded. Without having to go to CPA borrow.
And
so it's not like you're at ground zero in CPA.
Yeah.
CPC has to borrow 1.2 million.
CPA probably could afford to borrow $500,000. I mean, the revenues will still meet all the state requirements.
Which means a commitment of 330 or whatever from town funds, that covers the project.
That's Brian's scenario 1B.
Right.
That we're talking around.
Yeah. If you borrow 590 for the CPA for debt, you're looking at 830,000 or 41,000 a year. So you would cover it for that. But I think it would be if you don't get state grants, it would be a better sell to the public that we only need to borrow. While CPA would cover the borrowing for 500,000 versus 800,000, I think 500 is a more reasonable number to me, but easier sell to the public.
This is what it should have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So tonight we're not writing a warrant article here. We're making a recommendation so as to support grant applications to help us see if we can secure some of these state grants. And then we go from there with the proviso that it seems like we're in accord that we're willing to allocate the town funds to an amount of $300,000 or so. Is that not over where we're at?
$315,000. Yeah, there were three.
All right. So if that's what we need, we should make a motion to recommend that.
Finance Chair, want to go first? I make a motion we, the Finance Committee recommend scenario 2B.
Second.
All those in favor?
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay.
Just so I can clarify from my own understanding. So when you reference scenario 2B, you're talking about supporting the 315.
Yes, that's right.
Yes.
With no provisions on it?
Or with provisions? We're not worried about that yet.
Right now,
it's not an article.
It's not an article. When the article is written, then at that time, then we'll have to put some constraints around this.
But we know where the grant stands then? No,
but that's why the provision, because the warrant article is, it's codified at that point. So that's when you need the provisions. This is just a statement of good faith.
I'd like to make a motion for the support that we support scenario 2B with the $315,000 coming from the cell tower revenue account.
Sir.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Yep.
Okay. All right, so passed.
So tangentially, we'd also prefer, or I'd look for authorization to submit the culture facilities grant.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, great. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. You betcha.
While we are still here, can I just jump in, Brian?
Yeah.
At the last meeting that we had, we talked about the budgeting process. And in years past, each department would, for the most part, they would come before the select board, explain what they needed, select board would say yay or nay. And then they'd come to the finance committee, do the exact same thing all over again. We'd go yay or nay. And, you know, we've been talking about having the joint meetings,
right,
which we will. And so we talked about so we felt it would be best, and it would cut down the number of meetings for the departments, as
sure,
well as Brian, as well as Mary Ellen, and just have them come into one meeting. We can hear what they say. We can get an idea of where we're going, but hold off saying yay or nay until all the numbers are in.
And then we talk.
And then we can say who we support in total,
okay,
for the budget, given the fact that now we know money's coming in, money's going out, and we develop the calendar that way with that sort of time frame in mind.
And we have a scenario where we have sort of a side by side. Here are the options.
Right.
If you do this, you can't do X, Y, and Z.
Right.
If you do, you know, just so that you are comparing appropriately as opposed to just one after another, because then you want to be able to track it appropriately.
Yeah. You do, and you know, historically, in the last few years, there hasn't been a lot of no's coming from any of us in regard to budget needs. And you know, I think we've got to start looking at.
I agree.
Yeah, I think it's a good approach.
Yeah.
Just for information purposes, one of the bigger budget items is the school budget, either town or Frontier. When does that come in? Is that the 11th hour that you have to hurry up and decide? Or?
It has been in the past. And Yeah, we don't have a lot of control over...
Over our biggest budget.
Yeah. I mean, we just don't. It doesn't mean we can't voice our concerns.
Well, we usually spend 5 minutes on the school budget and about a half hour on a $700 shovel.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. So, so all we can do, Brian, is to try to get a hold of, you know, the superintendent's office and just try to get him in here as early as possible. And, you know, the elementary budget, we probably have a little more impact on that than the front to frontier.
I believe the school committee's meeting tonight.
Elementary.
Just the budget, the elementary school budget. So based on the results of that, we may have at least an idea of what it's going to come in at.
Right. I would make a suggestion that perhaps because the school budget is such a large nut that, and Paul, I completely understand we need to minimize meetings, but because the school is over half of the entire budget,
right,
maybe we have a meeting with everything else and then a meeting with the schools to demonstrate,
yeah,
to give it the due time.
We keep that separate.
Yeah, just because it's so huge.
And having everyone just be too long a meeting anyway.
Yeah. Right.
It's a rational way to break it up anyhow.
But one thing, I think we sold ourselves short a few years now, in that we tried to we tried to help out the meeting schedule of the superintendent as well as the budgeting office there so that they didn't have to come in here twice.
Right.
But what it does is it forces you to fly through each of the budgets because there's so much written, there's so little time. So I think we want to break up the elementary.
Sure.
And
okay. Sounds good to me. You guys?
Yes. Okay. Fine.
Very good.
And we have a meeting set to the 25th for the first.
Right, 25th?
Yeah. You've got the budgets, you've got some of them there.
I have some of them.
All right.
Okie doke.
And it'll be good to have, I think, a general discussion about budget outlook and those types of things.
Yeah.
When's the due date on budgets again?
Operating budget is January.
How far off can you put?
I don't know if ours is codified. How many days? Some of them are codified in the bylaws.
Oh, it has to. If you go, the reason the schedule is the way it is now, if you're going for debt exclusion or override, it was X number of weeks from a June election. Because that wasn't always the case, and we said, this is ridiculous. We need to, and it's why we separated it to the extent we did, because we were never able to do that when I first got on the security, whenever that was. So you can, as you push back the town meeting in terms of later in the year, it just means that the June election has to be moved
up
at the same time or later on in the calendar year as well.
I think it's 45 days.
Probably something like that, yeah. So if you have a May town meeting, ouch, you means you have an end of June
right. Election. It's just this calendar, this budget calendar, so that we get a real good sense of where our numbers are at and how we're going to recommend or not recommend on town floor. So I think the later we can have it, the better, I think.
But maybe Jonathan, you can probably answer this. Is there also a reason that we have them in June because the other three towns have theirs in June and you want to kind of get frontier budget approval?
You mean the election or the?
No, the
town meetings.
Okay, town meeting.
They're all within a week and a half.
Okay, because of that, so we can have time, more timely action on frontier budget rather than drawing it out for longer.
Yeah, and any budget that combines the resources of different towns, it sort of it leaves any department hanging, waiting for the next shoe to drop, so.
So if the other three towns are all the last week in April, then we should be somewhere.
It's hard to be much past that.
Around there, yeah.
Well, they've certainly bent over backwards for us during the last year or so. I guess we should return the favor. I'm trying to be sarcastic.
I'm not saying it.
That was.
All right.
Kind of good.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks.
You guys don't want to stand?
Is there anything that we should say?
More support.
You're selling out.
I'm not selling anything. I'm a very soft man. I need support.
Well, I can, yeah, sure.
No, I'm kidding you guys.
Let me see, what's here?
Not Thursday.
Okay, let's,
I'll go along.
I got it.
All right, see you guys, have a good night.
Good night.
So we've got public comment. Dan's had his comment, Richard?
I had a conference call with Mass IT today, and we're finalizing the scope of work. And they're gonna give us the $5,000, and then we're gonna go out, pursue a vendor to do the project.
That would go out to bid, or would that be just, is it under the threshold, so we can get one?
It's under the threshold, sound business practices.
Okay.
I got a call and an email, it might have been 2 weeks ago, about a second grant through the Community Compact Program, and that is to address budget documents. That was one of the other best practices that we'd selected. And that's also a $5,000 grant. What they're asking is that it go through FERCOG. There's a former employee of DLS there. I can't recall his name right now. But that's how they like to, that's how they like to work these budget document requests for communities in Franklin County.
How does it help us?
It'll give us more transparent and likely easier to understand budget documents than what we have right now. And hopefully, and we can also work on some financial policies, I hope. We don't have many in place in terms of how we would deal. For instance, how do we deal with free cash? So like you talk about a feeding frenzy. Do we have enough in stabilization? Do we have enough in capital stabilization? We don't really have anything in place.
No, it's a gut check.
So,
yeah, well, that sounds good.
All those funds would be dispersed.
How would this money be spent? I mean, this one and also the IT one, is that just goes to our budget for your staff, or are we hiring somebody to do this? Or
the IT grant?
Well, either one.
The IT, we would get an IT consultant to come in and do it.
Tell us what we need to do.
And limited to $5,000, or would we?
The grant is limited to $5,000.
Again, you're not getting a functional staff, you're getting an advisor, which is what we need to do to.
Yes.
The same with finance policy.
Yes. It's a consultant that will come in and.
Okay, and is it for the IT one, is that for just this building or all town?
We're going to extend it townwide.
Townwide?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, any of the town departments or offices, yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
So we do need.
Signature.
Signature.
Just me.
Yep, just here. That one. This is the contract for the budget. And this one here.
Okay, new business. APR on Long Plain Road. 204.
Put my book over. So whenever the Department of Agricultural Resources receives an APR application, they send to the community a, what's called a notice of proposed acquisition. And what they do is they ask that we read this notice into a record at a public meeting. So, if you don't mind, I will read this notice into the public record.
Please do.
At this meeting. In compliance with General Law Chapter 7C, Section 37, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, acting by and through its Department of Agricultural Resources, hereby gives notice that it proposes to acquire an APR on the real property identified herein for the purpose of protecting in perpetuity its superior and productive agricultural resources by preventing their conversion to other uses. The application received by MDAR, Massachusetts Department of Agricultural Resources, indicates that the property is owned by Richard E. Smith, Robert F. Smith, and William J. Smith, and consists of parcels located at Long Plain Road as approximately represented on the attached map. The APR may encompass all or parts of the area shown. The current use of the property is primarily for vegetables. Following the recording of the APR, the use of the subject property is limited to agricultural use as more particularly set forth in the APR document, the General Laws, Chapter 184, Section 31, and the regulations of the Department 330 CMR 22, and those sections following. Massachusetts Department of Agricultural Resources by Michelle Padula, APR Regional Planner. That was a mouthful.
The 204 is the house number, right, Richard? That's right. That's not the parcel number in question.
Right, there's no actual number assigned to the parcel by the town.
The assessor's office doesn't have the parcel number for that?
No, it's...
It's all part of, including 204?
I believe there is a separate parcel.
Well, it's a separate registration in Greenfield.
Right.
Different deed and so forth.
Right.
I thought you were referencing the street address. It doesn't have a street address of its own.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Okay. Basically, it's the farmland of, you know, around Dad's
right.
old house.
Right.
Yep. So it's map 21 block.
That's the parcel.
0 lot 5 is the right. parcel number. Yep.
Parcel number. Right.
Okay. I'm sorry for that.
Yeah. What's the acreage on that, Richard?
It's about 12 acres.
12 acres.
It's sandwiched between two existing APRs, so it would create a contiguous block.
Right.
Well, I mean, the state has approved it. It's
right.
We're just in the process of waiting for them to actually have some money.
Okay.
And there's also one other item that they sent to us, and this is really at the board's discretion. It's a consent to reduction of notice period. You've probably seen this before. There's a minimum 120 day notice period, which can be reduced to a 60 day notice period if the town so chooses. Has the Department of Agricultural Resources given a time frame on this or a timeline?
It's rather a generous timeline.
Yeah.
Basically, it's any time this year or next year.
Okay.
But they honestly don't know what federal funding is going to be available, and that's primarily where the money's derived from.
Yeah.
It was approved earlier in the year. They're in the process of negotiating with a surveying company to actually lay out, you know, the final boundaries and so forth.
Yeah.
The Agricultural Commission here in town has submitted an application on behalf to the Community Preservation Committee for matching grant and so forth, matching funds. Padula had indicated to me that it would likely be this spring that we would be moving forward. When actual monies change hands, I have no idea. So. We were fortunate, we were one of two projects in town that got federal priority based on the quality of the land and so forth. So.
If you'd like, I don't think the timeline is going to be what it is for, really what it is driven by availability of federal funds.
Okay. So, I apologize for not having more definitive information, but.
Well, then, I don't see any pressing need to.
Okay. Yeah, I guess it wouldn't be necessary.
Okay.
Because it's not going to happen within 120 we're not talking 120. Would it happen within 120 days?
That would be 4 months. I'd be surprised. I can't imagine a survey crew is going to go out there and try to find pins and stones and whatnot right now, so I don't know. You guys all set?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Richard.
District Local Technical Assistance.
District Local Technical Assistance Program, that's state funding that provides fund to the regional planning agencies to provide technical assistance to its member communities.
Okay. It's only spent money on, because that police consolidation went so far.
Oh, that was very helpful.
That was LTA money.
It's that same program. And that money is available, has been given to the regional planning agencies to survive the governor's 9C cuts. So that money is available.
So maybe we can get one time too, before that?
Yeah, a long time ago, very effective.
Should we revisit regional policing?
I'm not sure I have the stomach for it, thank you very much.
I don't.
I think I heard a proposal for regional fire that you're 1 year later.
Well, it depends upon how you interpret what he said. I think I've heard South Deerfield. No, I'm not gonna say anything.
So we have to.
They do a great job.
We have to pick projects here? Out of this list?
Well, they're not projects, they're just rating priorities. I mean, if you just want to, we can just talk generally about what we want to do, and I'll fill it in if that's more efficient.
You have to pick between one and three, I believe, or is that?
It talks about ranking the projects in the order of your interest, starting with one. That's the most important.
For line projects and in regional projects.
Well, yes, we've seen this before.
As much as I think we need village center economic development projects, I don't see how that's regional. Maybe I don't understand.
Well, that's a planning.
So there's three categories, planning projects, regional projects, and...
And this is for regional projects you're talking about, or is this across the board?
But this is across the board.
So we have to prioritize in each of the sections?
That's what they're asking.
Got it, okay.
So we start with housing planning? And work our way through this thing?
Yeah.
The one on the second page, it's called wetland, a wellhead protection plans to protect public drinking water supplies. Under that, can we do the combining the water districts and getting some kind of combined,
where do you see that?
Second page.
Starts with tree inventories?
Wellhead.
Yes.
Wellhead protection.
Typically a wellhead protection plan just focuses on the land uses surrounding the wellhead.
Right.
So that it doesn't become contaminated.
And we cross that bridge effectively and successfully.
Well, we're, yeah.
Right.
How many brownfields do we have in Whately? Do we have a sense of that? And we have the old landfill.
What was the question?
How many brownfields do we have in Whately?
You got old Fox.
Yep. The old landfill.
The old landfill. That might be it.
Really?
I don't think there's any defunct.
DeMeo's not brownfield?
The what?
DeMeo, the old DeMeo property's not brownfield? I don't think
well,
so.
Well, I don't think, unless they call it a septic brownfield. Yeah.
They didn't have tanks, right? They didn't have USTs?
What's that?
Underground storage tanks there?
No.
Just for septic.
Just for, yeah, there's not.
It's not a failed septic, is it?
No.
No, it
didn't. The building failed.
The building failed.
I think that we should try to figure out how to develop our old brownfields. You know, at least put solar on the old landfill, and I don't know what you could do with the...
Nobody's ever dared go near old Fox, so.
Why?
We've just always been afraid we're going to own it. So far, it's privately held.
Yeah, no, I get that. But could you do something with the land, is my question.
Well, personally, that was one of the ambulance sites, as everything was looked at way back.
way back.
I think it'd make a great pot dispensary, but I think it might be within 1,000 feet of the child daycare.
What daycare? Oh, across the pond.
Yeah.
16.
Because they're putting one in just on the other side of that, that red house across from Dunkin' Donuts.
Yeah. And they wouldn't approve two within that?
Well, if it was recreational, I don't think it's an issue. That's kind of like a liquor license concept. I believe it's going to be that way.
But regardless, could you do other things?
Yeah, it's a great spot.
And access?
Yeah, I think it's commercially zoned, obviously.
Obviously, right.
Railroad siding. The building's gone. They took the building down.
Under housing, we haven't had a housing needs assessment. There was one done 4, 5 years, 6 years ago. I don't know how. I mean, people say it wasn't complete and didn't tell us what we wanted to know.
At the risk of having a whole heck of a lot of people upset with me, I do think that we would benefit from some downtown or village center economic development projects. I think we just talked a lot about how we have a dramatic need for revenue in this town.
I totally agree, and I think if we're going to pursue town hall renovation, which it looks like we are, that would certainly could be a part of that. And I would like to see some sort of communication with our neighboring towns on a coordinated economic development, which this may not be able to do. But for instance, Deerfield has Yankee Candle and Mount Sugarloaf. It has tourist attractions. And I think we have Quan Quan, we have, you know, the center of town could be another destination of sorts. And we have a lot of organic agriculture in the town, which I think is noteworthy. And I agree with Jonathan. I'd like to see some economic development project.
And how do we be creative? I mean, what assets do we have that we don't even know we have? Right.
And we're located right next to the interstate. And I think it's, we get people to get off the interstate and not just go to Yankee Candle, but to come into Whately with a little more effort.
And you could argue that the Village Economic Development Center is not necessarily in our town center, but by the Sugarloaf shops, and because there's a lot of activity there. It's right on the railroad tracks. 116's there, 510's there, 91's there. You already have Sugarloaf shops, largely which are in Whately, that are underutilized. I mean, how can we make Whately a more economically desirable place for a business to plant a seed?
Right. No, I'd like to see that.
So what, that's under a second group, Development Village Center?
Yeah.
And economic development projects?
I mean, I don't want to spread ourselves too thin here, but maybe community food assessments, examination of the town's food system, which can include analysis of food supply and demand, economic development through food processing or distribution, increased food production of farmland, increased food access for residents and other elements. Well, part of that might be relevant in terms of economic development through food processing or distribution.
Yeah.
I mean, we're growing a lot of food in this town.
Where's the nearest added value facility or commercial kitchen?
Right.
Is this a greenfield?
There is one, yeah, at the incubator, whatever it's called.
Franklin's County CDC.
CDC, yeah.
I know a space we can rent.
Yeah, right, exactly. Well, you laugh. That might be a good idea, frankly.
You've got some major companies in town that are at the heart of our food supply and demand. I mean, look all over the road, and I don't know how. What would you be talking, trying to coordinate with them? And for a town to do something, I don't know, it's like the tail's wagging the dog, I guess. I don't know. you know, you've got Chang Farms, you've got Mannheim, you've got Norse, just the three big ones on River Road. I mean, well, are you looking at...
And Pachesna's not small, by the way.
No, Pachesna's, are you looking at something combining or involving all four of them, or is this...
Well, there are a lot of smaller people, too, and if we create a consolidated, centralized market, perhaps, or processing and market, or distribution site, that might benefit everybody involved.
Well, they've got the site down here, down the road here. Isn't that a food distribution site?
I think he's talking about preparation, like Norse would make jellies.
Well,
value-added stuff.
Okay. Well, and by the way, just this conversation tells me that we're talking about stuff we have no idea about, so this would be a good thing.
Well, that's right. That's right. We're not going to design.
No, we're not. And frankly, it goes pretty well with the downtown or village center economic development projects.
Exactly,
because
right. Maybe,
you know, while they're not inextricably linked, tangentially, they may be able to feed off of each other. No pun intended.
Get it? No, I totally agree with you, Jonathan. I think it's a nice synergy of our strengths, our assets, or our food production, our agriculture.
Right. And also, what other assets?
Scenery. Yeah. You know, our rural, we talked about our rural heritage and all that in our master plan. I think this is a good tie-in. So.
Those two?
Those two, anyway, and I don't think we want to.
No, because we have two other sections still to tackle.
Regional
projects and community compact projects. Regional projects. Regional fire service.
Well, I think if you look at
regional fire service,
develop Mass Rural Policy Commission recommendations, that certainly ties into what we were just talking about.
Learn about them, first of all. I mean, I haven't heard about what they're going to be suggesting, but. Do we have many abandoned properties? I don't think so, do we? I don't think so.
I don't believe so.
Vacant land, not abandoned properties.
We've got some empty house, but they're not, they're paying taxes.
Yeah.
Well, what about in the first page, their Development Mass Rural Policy Commission recommendations to.
Well, a lot depends on what they are. If we agree.
Well, pursuing legislation to help attract more volunteer expenditure. Maybe not. What's
that? Rural Economic Growth Center. Well, Rural Economic Growth Centers does sort of go hand in glove with the Village Center Economic Development Projects, but I just.
What the. Cooperative purchasing ideas. Are we doing any of that today?
I don't know.
Well, I don't know about schools, but for buildings, well, we get our own fuel prices, right? Is there a regional? I think doesn't FERCOG do some of that as well, or not?
Yeah, they do fuel bidding.
But this says specifically for local food for schools.
Well, that's the first one, but the other efficiency, energy efficiency.
And it says, please share your ideas, so I guess they're open.
But does Keith do any regional purchasing or stuff?
Yeah, I think it's solved all that.
Yeah.
I don't know who else would.
I think the schools were looking at, specifically the elementaries, where they all purchased their own, and I think they were trying to figure out how to do it better.
I think they do some already.
Do they?
Yeah, because it's a pretty tightly run ship in terms of what happens at the mothership.
Well, there's a new public safety collaboration, shared ambulance services.
We already do that, I think.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right.
I mean, talking about the unknown, and maybe it's worth finding out what kind of a situation we have. We have no idea what kind of substance abuse issues we have in town, and let's not kid ourselves that we don't have one. And clearly we probably have an opioid issue in town, because we're not exempt from that problem. So maybe, at the very least, we'd find out what impact substance abuse, including opioid addiction, is having on the campus. We're running blind here, at least I am.
Well, maybe the school and the police departments have some stake in that I don't know about. I mean, I don't know what the police department's doing. I don't know what the school's doing about opioid issues.
Right, we should be aware.
We should be aware, yeah.
And frankly, we don't know what other schools are doing. We don't know what other...
We don't know much about this.
And it is, I mean, if everyone else seems to be addressing this across the state, rightfully so, do we want to be the guys who are left on the platform as the train leaves the station?
Well, do we want to reinvent the wheel?
No, I that's fair.
I mean, there's a lot of work being done on substance abuse programs, so... I think our Board of Health would be involved in that.
Well, it'd be regional. I guess it's a regional, talking regional project.
Yeah. Well, the regional opioid task force.
There is one.
With a specific focus on municipal action steps. It's the second one.
Oh yeah, the top, yeah.
And that's going on right now, or there's all sorts of opioid research.
I mean, I think a lot of these from regional. My sense is that this would just be really our expression of support.
Which we should give.
For these activities.
Is there anything we could do with the senior center? South Deerfield, Southwest South County.
The future of that building is so up in the air. It's not a building that, if the senior center wants to grow, it's not a building that can satisfy that growth need. A lot has to be decided in terms of the direction of the physical location of the senior center.
And that be under new shared services, a regional.
No, we're already sharing those services.
Yeah, but to look at. Like you're saying, a new building or different location or something. It's a regional, you only got, what is there, two towns?
Three.
About three?
Sunderland, Whately, and Deerfield.
Okay. Well, I don't know.
Yeah, no, I in terms of how to help us figure out next steps, because we desperately need it and we can't, it's hard. It's not, it's not an easy situation at all.
Kind of wonder, well, you got public safety collaborations. It's not public safety, but public welfare collaborations, maybe, or something. And
it's almost sort of a strategic plan for the South County Senior Center.
Well, right, that's sort of what it is.
Yeah.
Here we could write it in.
Yeah?
Yeah, let's write it in. Because I'm sure I could get some buy-in from the other board members.
The Deerfield's getting that church next door.
Well, right, and that. But the question is that permanent or temporary for the senior center? And it's just an unknown.
No, I know. I know the Deerfield got a bid out tearing it down. So put another new shared service.
It's not a bad building for the senior center. It just needs some internal renovations.
Yeah,
because you got to break up the, you know, big cavernous room.
Right.
Well, that brings us to rank projects.
Well, no, we're at community compact projects.
That's right. Rank projects are education, energy, finance, housing. Now, what is this?
It says, please identify the specific best practices your town would like to pursue and rank order them. I mean, with me,
I think this has really to come. Is this due anytime soon?
It's to the 19th.
And we should.
Well, we know some of these are, don't we? Information technology is on there. I mean,
yeah, but we're going to decide on the ranking, and then we're going to have Brian and Mary Ellen go right up, because it says identify specific best practices, colon. It wants a listing.
Of what the best practices are.
And that's how I read it, but
I mean, we don't know what the best
practices are. Well, that's sort of my, we're sharing our best practices. That's how I see this. I don't know. That's my frustration, because this has to be, it's sort of like writing a book.
If I were your town, I'd like to pursue.
But my recommendation, I mean, we prioritize these this is the same as the community compact projects. It's the exact same thing. It's what we submitted.
So we've already done this?
Essentially, yeah.
Okay.
Essentially, we've already given our top. You know, I believe we did three or four.
Mm-hmm. What did we say? When we said, I think we said energy, environment.
Yeah.
We said housing, economic development.
Information technology.
IT, yeah. We didn't say transportation about work? No, we didn't. Right. Let's just cut and paste that then. Keep going, Paul?
Yeah, let's go. We've got a long way to go here.
Seriously?
Yeah, well, yeah. It won't close.
Eight items. Okay, notes on, well, we did that. District local technical assistance apps.
Yep.
I lost my budget.
The MMA annual meeting and trade shows, January 20th and 21st.
Are you going?
Yeah, I was going to go.
Good.
Yeah. Really, two orders of business for the MIIA and MMA annual meetings. There needs to be a voting delegate.
You will love the lunch, Brian. Enjoy yourself.
So, are you going to be our voting delegate?
Oh, no, no. That's why I said you will enjoy the lunch. Enjoy yourself.
You can be our voting delegate.
I may be at the lunch, but you will be the voting delegate.
You're going, Jonathan?
Yeah.
Okay. Good. We got that covered. Highway truck loan documentation.
For both of those, the MIIA and MMA. They authorized me to.
Yes.
For both of those.
Where's that, Boston or Worcester?
What? The highway truck loan.
The annual meeting.
Boston. So the sheriff, the higher. Not the high, the, you know, the convention center.
Hines. Yeah.
That's that.
Truck.
Where did the truck?
Truck
those are those eight different documents.
Oh, the Boston Post Can Award.
Boston Post Can. Beatrice Duda.
We have an observation on that at this point. She's in the hospital, so I'm waiting to hear from her.
Who had it?
All right.
Was it Ginny? Not Ginny.
Mary Roop.
Mary Roop.
Yeah.
And how old is Bernice?
She qualified. I don't have that number.
Well, age of 98. Okay, it says here.
Okay, we're all going to qualify some.
Hopefully. So you never know. Okay, committee appointment, Fred Barron to the Housing Committee.
We probably should have moved that up on the agenda.
Yeah, just thinking about that. Yeah.
Well, let's appoint.
Okay, fine.
We're good with that?
Yeah.
All moved?
Yep.
Voted? Yes. Minutes, sign off.
Do you want to talk about that?
Would you consider, a lot of towns are going to have the town administrator sign off on the minutes, so would you consider doing that rather than?
I sure would.
Okay.
Rather than having one of us do it?
Right. You
yeah,
would still
I'm
approve,
fine with that.
You would still approve them, but Brian would sign off on them.
Oh, we still approve them?
We'd still
approve I haven't them. Signed, am I the secretary right now?
Yeah, you're going
to I haven't signed a document.
Yeah, now that I'm caught up, you're going to be signing. But
okay, but
going forward from this point on, is it okay if Brian signs off on it?
Fine with me.
Are you sure you want to?
Okay.
We will still see them, but
so you're right. Still going to approve them. They're okay. Not going to be signed
it's
off.
It's moved, seconded, and
done.
Unanimous. Okay. Okay, Northampton Cooperative Auction Bar.
Common victual license, right? They're going to sign this?
They're going to start selling beer? What are they doing?
No, that's what the rec commission.
Oh, right. Okay.
Alcohol.
I just keep thinking of victualers, you know.
Well, yeah, what is this?
If you have sell food and have a place to sit down and eat it, then you need to get a victual license. It has nothing to do with alcohol.
All right, victualer. Victual.
I think he'd do a booming beer business.
I bet he would, yeah. Especially this time of year.
Oh, and I...
It doesn't say strong waters, just...
I guess there's some administrator updates or no?
How fast can I talk, right?
I can listen as fast as you can talk.
All right. Manganese filtration project, that's the project still moving forward. The town received its project approval certificate from Mass DEP, which means they approved the project, and that gets, they approved the project. There's still a couple other items that the consultant needs to submit.
Okay.
They approved the project, and we have a letter from the Mass Clean Water Trust, which says you need to submit these documents before we issue your, so a loan commitment request letter is what it is.
Okay.
So that's moving forward. I have a conference call set up with Berkshire Engineering, Wayne, the Mass DEP, so we'll all get on the same page moving forward.
When does this project look like it might?
It needs to go out to bid in the summer.
Oh, okay.
It's either by the end of June, I believe, in terms of the commitment from the trust.
This is obviously taking longer than any of us had originally hoped for.
Yeah.
Are we confident that there's not a public safety issue as the process drags on?
We are. You're nodding.
I'm hearing his question. I'll have to double check.
I mean, what's the level? What's the?
It's just above.
But is it still just above?
I'm not sure. I haven't seen recent tests. I don't know what the recent tests are. I mean, how this came about was the level of manganese was what it was in the water for how many every years it's been drinking water in Whately. What changed was the threshold, Mass DEP threshold.
Right, okay.
It's not that the manganese levels went up, it's that the threshold went down.
Okay.
And probably for some reason related to research, one would hope.
I would imagine.
And the question I would have is, what's the problem with manganese in the first place for health? Or is it health related at all, as opposed to like hard water scaling or corrosion or something else?
I believe it is. I believe it is related to public health.
Public health.
But I don't recall exactly.
Could we find out more about this?
Yes.
Just for public education.
I thought we already had somebody who was going to do this system. I thought that was like the next step.
Yep, this is the financing step.
Oh, the bid for finance.
But doesn't the water department?
No, it would still go out to bid. Although there is.
Didn't we have a pilot plant?
There will be a pilot study, yeah.
But don't we already own that? The materials for it? And then we were going to expand the pilot plant if it worked.
Yes, they have the system, I guess for lack of a better description, on loan essentially.
Yeah. Okay. But when we go out to bid, it may not be the same people that we have this on loan from.
It doesn't have to be, but I'm told the system is unique.
Gotcha.
Okay.
But does the water department puts out an annual brochure or something that explains water quality and all that? I haven't seen it lately, but isn't that explain the manganese situation? I don't know if it comes out the next water bill or what.
There's a water quality report.
Yeah, there is a water quality report. Maybe put the latest one online, I guess.
Can I ask a question? Does the water department must check the water quality regularly? Yeah. Okay, and so that water system that they check covers roughly how many households?
600?
No, that's the whole town.
No, it's like 400 maybe.
400. 400. Yeah. So the 400, now I as a homeowner with my private well and, don't have that assurance. Nobody tests my water. And it's very hard to get your water tested. In fact, you have to take it to Belchertown or something like that. I'm wondering, since we already test water in Whately for the rest of the town, could homeowners that aren't on the town water bring water samples to whoever's testing it for us to get it tested?
I don't know.
Could we find out?
Sure.
Because I think that would be a nice public service.
Yeah.
And, I'd be willing to pay for it if there's a fee involved. If somebody's testing our town water every week or maybe whatever.
Yeah, not sure.
Well, I think Wayne tests it very often because they have to adjust the amount of chlorine and other stuff they're putting there based on the condition of the water.
Right.
It depends on how.
And I'm sure they do different tests than you would for a home water system. You'd be more involved in coliform and all sorts of other things. It may not pertain to a public water system. Okay. All right. What else?
Green Communities project. The LED lighting upgrades at the elementary school have been completed.
Yay.
And the energy control system work is scheduled to end this Friday.
Great.
So can we apply now for, did we make it under the gun?
Yes. So I'll be doing the final reporting in grant closeout.
For a new
in January.
Green
and spring. As long as the grant is closed out by mid-February, the community is eligible to apply.
Oh,
the next
round. Okay, so we'll be eligible.
Yes.
Right, and it's already spoken for with it.
With the what?
With the town hall project.
Right. I really wanted to see solar collectors on the town hall. But...
Well, that brings, go ahead, Brian, because I want to talk about solar.
Williamsburg Road Bridge, our small bridge grant application has been forwarded to Boston for review. That doesn't mean.
Oh, good.
That doesn't mean.
Review. Oh,
come on.
Review. That's like tailing, isn't it?
There were 70 applications submitted for this first round. And it's the money's $50 million over 10 years. So there's two rounds each year. So there's $5 million. 70 applications.
Well, we're only talking, you know, thousands of dollars here. We're
and
not talking
million,
millions.
Right? Yep.
It adds up quick, though.
Well, okay.
Yeah.
All three bridges. Would
can't
be
we buy a bridge for cheap?
So have we eliminated the temporary bridge concept, which is where we were before these grants came?
Right, surplus bridges lying around in somewhere.
But my understanding is that the temporary bridge will be moved up the road.
What?
What do you mean?
Moved up the road?
Because there's a bridge. I believe it's one further up the road.
Up the same, up on Williamsburg Road, yeah.
There's two bridges.
It also needs
to be
work, so.
Replaced.
If
we get this grant, the temporary bridge will just go to the second bridge.
That's the hope, yes.
Right. Okay.
That's how the grant is written, yeah.
And then we'll get a new bridge on the first bridge.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Eventually.
Complete streets. I told you in the past that the funding was on hold. That funding has now been taken off hold. It's been reduced. Towns are eligible to apply for $35,000 in assistance to complete your prioritization plan. So we found that out, and I
what
came last
it,
week to try to ask.
Before it got cut?
$50,000.
Okay.
And it, a combination of two things happened. I was told one was communities weren't spending the $50,000, and their funding was drying up. So.
One sounds plausible, the other sounds political. But okay.
Does that mean you're done?
I can't be. One other thing. Mill River Stabilization Project. That we're still working with the consultants to wrap that up. But just as an FYI, there is going to be some ongoing monitor requirements of the rare species on that site, which is just kind of a reminder.
Can't they look after them?
You guys probably are aware of that, but just a reminder that that's...
Is that going to cost us a lot of money?
It's going to cost some money.
But we knew that going. We knew that...
It was $10,000 a year or something.
Yeah, it was we were well aware of that.
The requirements are going to become less...
Stringent as time goes on and these species establish
less
themselves.
Money. Exactly.
And it is completely out of our hands.
And that's right. All right, good.
So.
Okay.
And we've stopped mowing the site, so it helps.
Did we stop mowing the site? It wasn't
right. Somebody mowed it accidentally.
Oh, yeah.
Not one of our guys.
Okay.
The only
I want solar on the elementary school, and I want solar on the landfill.
I want solar on this building.
Fine. Let's solar up.
Let's solarize everything.
Let's solarize Whately. Yeah, solarize Whately.
There's also that parcel of land to the south of there. You don't put it on the school, you can put it on the land. There's 4 acres there.
It would act as a buffer against drift.
Yeah.
To the south?
Yeah. That's even more area than
exposed.
You're going to get on
the
school.
We don't own that for it.
Yes, we do. Where the The circle goes around on the backside, it's clear, there's a clear...
You mean where they have gym class?
Yeah. I don't know what they have there, I don't know.
That's where they have gym class.
Wait, they have, they do that in the front?
No.
I don't know.
No.
But where that tree line is, I don't think that's a boundary.
No.
The leach fields in there.
But we really should be looking into getting probably 200 kW on the old landfill. I don't know what would go on this building. I don't know what would go on the elementary school, and I don't understand why... Who's on the energy committee for crying out loud?
Which old landfill are you talking about?
We haven't.
On Long Plain Road.
Which one? There's two.
Either one. Both.
The one on the left hand side as you're going...
What are you talking, across from the school?
Yeah, across from the school or across from the last excavating?
Okay.
Across from excavating.
Okay, let's solarize here, seriously.
The other option is at Tri-Town Beach.
Sure.
I mentioned it before, outside that gate, and that's right adjacent to this other one over here, I mean.
Tri-Town Beach is the perfect example of how the economic development plan that we're going to get through this LTA, that is a gold mine for economic development, and it just sits there and nobody uses it. You could give it to somebody, let them put a restaurant up there, they can give a reduced rate to Whately residents.
There's like 10 acres.
Because it's a lost opportunity right now in Whately.
There's like 10 acres there.
All right.
Of land there, so.
You got your marching orders.
I got your
orders. Solarize everything.
Did you find that thing, by the way? I don't want to say what thing it is.
I have not found it. Okay. I went to the depths of the center school basement, nothing there.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
I have two other quick ones. A while ago, we got money for the compactor.
Yes.
So are we pursuing that or taking that or what? What's happening with that?
We have the grant money.
Right.
Right. But that pays for less than half of the compactor. A capital project request has been submitted for the CPIC to review.
So we're going to pursue that.
Yep. It's for the CPIC to review.
Okay. The other thing. Jogs my memory that we got a thing in here, Conway 250. I guess we have to decide on this, but two things come to mind. I think we should be setting aside money in this budget season for our celebration here. I don't know, like 10,000, whatever, every year. So people the last year don't get blindsided with, oh, you want to spend, you know, $50,000 on a celebration if we do it over several years. And I guess I would also send this to the other committees in town. Maybe they want to participate. It's not just the select board, because, you know, there's a lot of organizations that are in a parade and celebration.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
It's 23, right? Is that right?
What? Ours is 21.
Oh, right. My house is 23.
But let's look into, you know, finding some company to underwrite our celebration as opposed to having it come out of, you know, the Norse Farm, Whately 250, that's sponsored by Norse Farm, I.
And we did ask...
And I'm not picking on Norse, could be anybody.
No, I know, yeah, that is...
You don't like riding a big strawberry.
We did ask if there was state money on this, but when Kulik was at our meeting, and he says, yeah, there is a token amount.
I wouldn't bank on that.
Their big effort is the 1620 celebration.
Is that Plymouth?
Yeah.
Plymouth, that's going to be huge.
Yeah, there's money set aside for that, but he said there was.
Boy, people like birthday parties. We could use this money for the town hall.
All right, like I said, motion to adjourn.
That's all.
Second, okay. And let's go into the night and have a good one.